Listen to this verse, and here is a classic example of one God versus three chairs. If you deny me before men, I will deny you before my Father. You know what it says? What it really says? If you deny me before men, I will deny your denial before my Father. If you deny me before man, I'm going to say to my Father, pay no attention. He has no idea what he's doing. I deny that denial. He's your advocate, right? Do you understand how drastically different that is? Because over there you got a fickle God who's waiting for you to deny him somehow, whatever that means. I'm sorry, you screwed up. I'm going to say to my dad, yeah, we're done with him. There's a scene in the shack. In fact, chapter, is it 15, Festival of Friends? 15, I think. And that chapter is in the book, the way I wrote it, the day I wrote it. It was the only chapter never touched in a rewrite. And it was part of a day in which I wrote four chapters. I got caught in a river and ended up 20 miles downstream, pretty bloody and naked. I mean, it just wrecked me. And the fourth of those, and that's the chapter with the lights and the reconciliation with the dad. And in that chapter, there's a scene. And Mac is standing on a hill at a distance next to Sadhu, the Holy Spirit. And they watch Jesus come into the middle of adoration from a distance. And Mac is watching, and Jesus in the middle of the family, as it were, turns and catches Mac's eye from a distance, and Mackenzie hears him say to him, "That's great timing." Thank you for that. That was like perfect. And Mackenzie hears Jesus say, "Hey Mac, I'm especially fond of you." Now that was, in a little microcosmic sense, how I'd felt about being in the kingdom. Like I was just inside the door and hoping nobody would notice. You know, like I was ruining the party if I was present. And so I'm watching it from a distance. And my connection to that becomes, I'm especially fond of you. I give the book to my kids. And one of the questions that comes up was, you gave this story to your kids, how did it touch them? Or I get a phone call from Andrew, who's 21 years old at the time, a mechanical engineer, and he calls me up on the phone, and he's been bawling. He is just weeping. And when he gets a little control, he said, "I've been crying for 2 hours." I said, "What's going on?" He said, "You know chapter 15 where Mackenzie's standing at a distance, and Jesus says to him, 'I'm especially fond of you.' I heard him say that to me." After your own child gets penetrated by something that you have created, you think I care if anybody doesn't like the book? Who was the precious, lovely lady who asked about 2 Thessalonians? That was you. I want to honor that question. I went back and worked on that and went back into the Greek and tried to deconstruct it in a way that would make some sense. It was a little late at night and you get into specifics and you're going, okay, I know that there are answers in here this way or that way. And so I want to come back to that question, which will lead into what Baxter wants to talk about. So I broke it down, and here is a word-for-word translation of the Greek. Okay? Now, verse 9. The tense is future active. Who shall be? Who will be incurring? Now, here's what the words are. Whole, W-H-O-L-E, whole slash ruining. Verse 9 of 2 Thessalonians chapter 1. 2 Thessalonians 1, 9. It's this almost apocalyptic passage, revelational, unveiling, right? And it sounds like he's really ticked off, if you just read it from our English translation. Now, Baxter brought up a point, and he's right, in terms of the word apo, A-P-O. In the Greek, apo means from. That source language, it comes from something, right? Away from is wrong. In verse 9, apo is used twice. Very specifically from, apo. And here's where it fits. Okay. Who shall be incurring whole ruining justice? Those are the words. In a justice that entirely ruins or dismantles for and it's translated eternity. So the way it's translated in English is eternal judgment, right? The Greek is aionion, and aionion is a very specific word that is translated myriads of ways, and it means the essential word behind aionion is it mystery, Baxter, or is it what's the word? There is it's a time word, but it's an unknown passage of time, an unknown passage of time, because they don't have an infinite construct in their heads, right? And it's often translated as an age of time because you don't know how long this duration is. So aionion, sometimes it's singular, sometimes it's plural, so it's sometimes translated sphere or world, but it's an unknown encounter or duration. Right? So they're going to be incurring absolutely dismantling justice for an unknown or indeterminate period of time. From two things. Now, this goes back to verse 1 where it says, grace to you from the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, right? That's the word apo. It's not away from. It makes no sense to be away from. You know, grace to you away from. It originates in the Father, right? This grace from, apo. So here, this whole dismantling justice for an indeterminate, they're going to face this, right? Which is all of our unbelief is going to face this. But in this cataclysmic section, it's saying, look, there is nothing we're going to get away with in this. All of your unbelief, you think somehow you crossed a threshold and now you do it perfectly, right? Good luck with that, right? So from the, it's translated presence, but it's actually the face. From the face of the Lord or the Master. From the face, from, right? This overwhelming justice, this dismantling is going to come from being in the presence of the Master and from the strength of His glory. And glory, as our friend, David Walkup, who has written a book called The Glory of God or The Glory or... Yeah, Glory, it's just come out. Yeah, he's from Adelaide, and he's a friend of ours, but it's a beautiful book, and he has really worked on this idea of glory, and glory is the essential nature of something. So Jesus is the glory of the Father, because he is a revelation of the essential nature of the Father, Right? So glory is the essential nature of a person, place, or thing. That which is absolutely at the core of its being. So this dismantling justice is going to be from the very presence. You take your crap and face to face with Jesus, he is going to blow it away and burn it away. It's just by being in light. All your darkness is going to get shredded, right? So you're going to experience this absolutely dismantling justice from the presence of the Lord and the strength of his glory. All right? MacDonald says, in light of these kinds of things, vengeance might as well be the same thing as salvation, as mercy, as justice. Got it? Now, let me read you something in light of that. And it's a quote from a theologian. And this will help tie in some pieces of this together, because this is a brilliant quote. And then I'll tell you who wrote it. And it wasn't Baxter. Some recent theologians are of the opinion that the fire which both burns and saves is Christ himself, the judge and savior. Here's a great question. Would you rather be judged by God the Father or by Jesus? Anybody want to pick one? Everybody wants to be judged by Jesus, right? Why? Because we have a dislocation between the one God and the love of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, right? So even in our minds, we would rather be judged by Jesus than by God the Father. Because we have this inherent sense of darkness behind the back of Jesus that has to be appeased. Do you understand? Well, good news. Good news. John says, the Father judges no one, but has given all judgment into the hands of his Son. That's in the Bible. It's in the red letter section. So guess what? You get what you want. You're not going to be judged by the Father. I mean, just that little bit. Doesn't it kind of turn the world on its head? All right. So some recent theologians are of the opinion that the fire which both burns and saves is Christ himself, the judge and savior. The encounter with him is the decisive act of judgment. Before his gaze, all falsehood melts away. This encounter with him, as it burns us, transforms and frees us, allowing us to become truly ourselves. All that we build during our lives can prove to be a mere straw, pure bluster, and it collapses. Yet, in the pain of this encounter, when the impurity and the sickness of our lives becomes evident to us, there lies salvation. That is that ongoing sense and future tense of salvation that has already been accomplished in Christ's passion, which he will also say. His gaze, the gaze of Jesus, the touch of his heart heals us through an undeniably painful transformation as through fire. But it is a blessed pain in which the holy power of his love sears through us like a flame, enabling us to become totally ourselves and thus totally of God. Do you understand that part of the beauty of this is that God does not want to annihilate your being? He wants to celebrate it. What kind of love is this? It is other-centered self-giving. Oneness and your oneness in this becomes a celebration of you. Why do you think God wants all the bits and pieces that aren't you to be destroyed? Because it's you he loves. And for you to become fully yourselves is to experience more fully the life here. And knowing becomes the basis of love and relationship. Like we know in our hearts, we know with our children, we know with our grandchildren, we know with that one whom we love. Infatuation, romanticist love, is not based on knowing at all. It's actually based on not knowing. Thank you, sir. Pornography is the projection of our own crap onto an image and an imagination of someone we don't know so that we can use that person to love ourselves. And we don't have to take the risk of knowing or relationship. And that's just one example. In fact, if you become romanticistically infatuated with someone, guess what happens when you get to know them? It kind of all falls apart. Right? But think if those of you who are grandparents or parents, and as you grow in the knowledge of that child, doesn't it seem like the world just continues to expand? This universe continues to expand, and it's like it gets bigger and bigger and bigger, right? And unique, and the nuances and the colors of that relationship get wider, and the hues get more varied, and because you're coming to know them. And it's not just here, right? It's here. It's here. It is the whole thing. All right. But it is a blessed pain in which the holy power of His love sears through us like a flame, enabling us to become totally ourselves and thus totally of God. In this way, the interrelation between justice and grace also becomes clear. The way we live our lives is not immaterial, but our defilement also does not stain us forever. If at least we continue to reach toward Christ, toward truth, and toward love. Now understand this. The reaching toward does not change our identity. It destroys the things that are not true about us. The word sin, hamartia, that is often translated missing the mark, right? Well, it comes from two Greek pieces. Ha, which is a negation, a negative. Ha, right? Ha, martiri. Now, ha means without or apart from. Meros, which is the root for martiria, meros means form or essential design. Sin is any time you function as a negation of your intent, the intended design of who you are. We've reduced it to a set of moral activities. No, this is about who you were intended to be. When you function in a negation of that, that's sin. And you can understand that it's a violation of who you are. At the core of your being. And yes, it expresses itself in certain kinds of behavior that are rather obvious, but there's a lot of behaviors that are not so obvious. You're designed to be a child in a relationship with a father you can trust. And when we are anxious about things and we don't realize how much we're loved, we are functioning apart from our design. And the intention of it, which is fundamentally relational. Does that make sense to you? Okay. So, indeed, it has already been burned away through Christ's passion. See, he's trying to juxtapose the fact that salvation is a completed thing. This is 2 Corinthians chapter 5. This is, you know, all died. And when he rose, all rose. You are anyone who is in Christ, which would include the entire cosmos, is a new creation. They just don't know it. The good news is not, hey, if you do the right magic words and do the right things, you get to go in. No, the good news is you've already been included in this. He's already given you His relationship with the Father, His anointing with the Holy Spirit. That's the truth about who you are. Now, having been raised with Christ, set your mind on things that are real. Not all this earthly crap that we've added to this whole thing. That's the verse that Malcolm was talking about right off the very beginning of today. At the moment of judgment, we experience and we absorb the overwhelming power of His love over all the evil in the world and in ourselves. The pain of love becomes our salvation and our joy. Consider it all joy when you experience this and this and this. Why? Because it's going to tear apart all the crap that you have associated with the truth about who you are, and it's wrong. And in that burning transformation, you are going to emerge as someone who is authentic, who is a truth teller, who knows how to trust, who knows how to give. It is clear. Now, this is very important because this comes right smack into the middle of Thessalonians and everything else. It is clear that we cannot calculate the duration of this transforming burning in terms of the chronological measurements of this world. It is clear that we cannot calculate the duration of this transforming burning in terms of the chronological measurements of this world. That's Ionios. You cannot calculate. And for us to simply make it infinite in duration is wrong. They don't have that concept in their understanding. This transforming, quote unquote, moment, however long the duration of that moment is, this transforming moment of this encounter eludes earthly time of reckoning. It is the heart's time. It is the time of passage to communion in the body of Christ. In Him. The judgment of God is hope. Both because it is justice and because it is grace. If it were merely grace, making all earthly things cease to matter, God would still owe us an answer to the question about justice. Don't you feel that? There has to be an answer to the witch doctors who cut up babies. There has to be a response to Hitler and Pol Pot and Noriega and abuse and what we do, there has to be a response to that. We demand justice. Amen. And we do it from our heart. And this is saying, if this is merely grace, then none of what you do actually matters. And there's no answer for justice. The judgment of God is hope, both because it is justice and because it is grace. If it were merely grace making all earthly things cease to matter, God would still owe us an answer to the question about justice, the crucial question that we ask of history and of God. A lot of the reason people, and in a sense rightfully so, have a problem with universalism, and again, let me repeat, we aren't there. But the reason is because it seems to make nothing matter. And when it comes down to it, if we're honest, we want justice for the things that we've done wrong. The ways we hurt people. We want real reconciliation and restoration for the kinds of things that we've been involved in that added to the damage in the world. It is a cry about ourselves as much as it is anybody else. And God, because God responds in terms of justice, is saying, you do matter. And even the choices that you made that were destructive matter. That's a high view of humanity. If it were merely justice, in the end, it could only bring fear to us all. 1 John, there is no fear in love. People say, well, what about, you know, fear is the beginning of wisdom and all that. And there's all those verses about fear and stuff and fear the Lord. Let me tell you, there's a very difference between fear that is based in a distrust and a mistrust of character, right? Where you have a phobic response to something, and an awestruck wonder at this. You know, fire is a scary thing. If you've ever been around it, when it seems to be out of control, in love there is no fear. That's a point blank statement. So whatever that kind of fear is, it's antithetical to love. In fact, perfect love casts out fear. In fact, the degree that we have fear in our lives is the degree we don't know we're loved yet. That's what 1 John's saying. Because fear involves judgment. That's what it says. Read 1 John. If it were merely justice, in the end, it could only bring fear to us all. Now listen carefully. The incarnation of God in Christ has so closely linked the two together, judgment and grace, that justice is firmly established. Guess what? We all work out our salvation with fear and trembling. We're human beings. We're bringing crap to the table. And in our humanity, we're going to work this out. God will not heal you from your stuff apart from your participation. There is no extreme soul makeover where he just does it to you and fixes you while you're off to Disneyland somewhere. Don't we all want extreme soul makeover? Please. You know, give me a red or a blue pill. You know, this process crap? Hate it. And yet I love it. Because it honors me in the middle. God somehow is able to extricate the things that are not true, all the shadow stuff, and leaves me intact. What kind of a miracle is that? We all work out our salvation with fear and trembling. Don't forget the other part of that verse. This is Philippians. It says, for it is God in you working to will and to do his good pleasure, which is for you, is participation. So justice is firmly established. You will be judged by your works. What you do actually matters. Grace is not by your works at all, nor is faith. Not of works, lest any man should boast, right? We're saved by faith, by grace, by Jesus' faith in the Father. Judgment is a recognition that your choices matter. Nevertheless, grace allows us all to hope and to go trustfully to meet the judge whom we already know as our advocate, or parakletos. 1 John 2:1. Is that not stunning? Does that not help? Trying to put some of these pieces together.
Can we find that anywhere, Paul?
Yes. Pope Benedict. Pope Benedict, he wrote this. If you go on Google and you look up two words, spe salvi, S-P-E, S-A-L-V-I, space salvi, in hope of salvation. Pope Benedict wrote it. It's an encyclical on the hope of salvation, and this, what I read to you, is section 47.
What year was it?
It was just like 5 years ago. maybe not even that. Pope Benedict wrote that, so it automatically is wrong, right? Listen to me. Do you understand that there are elements of what he is dealing with that is grasping this conversation in a way that's incredibly helpful? Relationship of grace and justice. This is why people react against kind of flimsy grace, you know? Because it doesn't deal with justice. It doesn't allow us to be angry about the things that are wrong. And about, this needs to be right, this needs to be reconciled, right? That is an overview of trying to deal with that 2 Thessalonians passage in a way that is honoring to the question. You're welcome. Does that help? Okay. All right, Baxter, you're on.
I saw on the trip over on the ferry, first time, and I've known Paul for several years now, I've never seen him quiet. And he stood there and he wasn't doing this. And he wasn't doing this.
Watching the horizon.
I know, he was dialed in on the horizon while the boat was going like this.
I did keep my supper.
In my part of the country, Mississippi is an agrarian culture still. Mississippi Delta is super flat. That's where all the farms are, a lot of the Delta farms, and then this rolling hills. And some years way back, someone brought in, I think from China, I'm not real sure about that, but a vine called kudzu. And it was designed to help us with some of the erosion issues that we were having with the big hills were just beginning to disintegrate. So they planted this, and it works. It really does cut down on erosion. But it also takes over everything. And I remember one day I was out in the woods, and I was hunting, and in the wintertime, because I would never go in the midst of these kudzu vines in the summer, because you'd have snakes and I don't know what, but it's not a good place. And I came to this house that you could no longer even see from 100 yards or 100 meters. And I stood there and I looked at this thing and I thought, the kudzu has absolutely overtaken it and overshadowed it so that it's not even visible until you walk almost right on it. And I remember thinking, and this has been really helpful to me, the kudzu never became the house. It wrapped around it, it hid it, it had it covered up from sight, but it never was able to penetrate into housedom. And right when I saw that, I thought, that's very important, because I was taught as a child within the Reformed tradition that I was totally depraved. The kudzu had become me, and that's all I was. And then I realized that the whole problem that we have of sin, of the fall, of the things that we've done wrong, are really flowing out of that kudzu that has managed to wrap itself around our soul. And it is so close to us that if you walked over and you cut off a piece of that kudzu, we would feel it as if something of us was cut off. You with me? Now, what's important there for me is that I am not the kudzu. You are not. You are not sin. You and I are in Jesus. But we bring into this a lot of kudzu. And Jesus is not going to do the instant grit thing. But, you know what grits are? Anyway, he's not going to flip a light switch and all the kudzu is just magically going to unwrap. Because the reason it's there is because we have given it a place there. You know, when you're told you're totally depraved, you're not too surprised when you do something. And then you do it and it starts beginning to be a habit and a pattern, a way of seeing, and all of a sudden you got this huge big kudzu vine wrapped around and you don't even know what's going on, and you can't, for the life of you, you try to act like you don't have kudzu on you. You know? But you do. And it's all in there. And it affects your mind and it affects your ears and it affects the way you see and the way you hear, what you see, what you hear. And that has to be dealt with. It's not because the Lord doesn't love us. He's saying, no, that's not you. You're all covered up in this vine. and I'm going to come in, he says. I've got you, and I've got the kudzu too. I've got all of it, because I'm not going to lose. And this beautiful scene, you know, when Jesus feeds the 5,000 in John's Gospel, and he says, after it's over, he says, gather up the last fragments. See that nothing is lost. And I was reading that one day, and I thought, why would he bother to make that comment? And I thought, get all of Baxter. Get all, don't leave any fragment behind. And if you read the prayer that I gave you last night, every war-torn fragment, every bit of this, he is not going to lose one hair. And in his redeeming genius, and only the love of the Father, Son, and Spirit can do this, can begin to unwrap this kudzu. And as Paul says so beautifully, he never does this without our permission. This is where we vote. This is where we vote. This is where we were saying to Jesus and to the Father and the Holy Spirit, listen, I realize I can't do this. And I realize that the preacher can't do this. I've tried 3 different preachers' versions of doing this, and it didn't work. We are both outclassed in the sense that we stand in the midst of something that is too beautiful for words. We cannot even begin to say what we're seeing and what we're experiencing. And at the same time, we're outclassed in that we have an enemy that has found a way to wrap itself around us in our lives. And then that kudzu starts going down through the generations. And really, it's probably coming back from all the way back from Adam. And Jesus is the only one that can begin to unravel that in our lives. And he does. And that's why it is so important. And I know for some of you, it's so difficult to get a hold of this basic idea. This is why I stand and I will fight for this. I am not kudzu. You are not kudzu. And it's not because you're created in the image of God. It's because Jesus Christ has found you, all of you, and has you. Every war-torn fragment, every broken, shame-riddled part in Him, in the Father, in the Holy Spirit. If you lose that, you're lost. You have no way. Because then it's somehow or another, it's up to you to figure out how you can get there. And that's so much of what we have done in our Christian experiences. We're trying to figure out how to get someplace that in fact we already are. That's why we're so beholden to everyone that comes along and says, here it is, and then make sense out of this passage and do this, and off we go. But we start with Jesus. We don't even start with a kudzu. We start with Jesus. And who is Jesus? He's the Father's Son. Face to face, in the Father. If you've seen me, you've seen the Father. No one knows the Father but the Son. And we start with Jesus as the one in all of biblical history and all of creation history. He's the only one who is anointed in the Holy Spirit as an abiding permanent gift. And Jesus is the Creator. One of the reasons that we really have gotten we've gotten ourselves into a situation where we're so beholden and so vulnerable is because we've lost in the West the biblical insistence that Jesus is the Creator. Like I was saying the other night, He is the Creator. He is the one in and through and by and for whom all things have come into being. So when you speak Jesus' name, you're saying something about all creation. You're saying something about God the Father. You're saying something about God the Holy Spirit. When you speak the name of Jesus, you're saying that He's the one in the Father, He's the one anointed in the Holy Spirit, and He's the one who has gathered the whole creation in Himself. He already had a relationship with you before He became human. He's establishing His relationship with you in His humanity, and then He's going to take that down into His death and resurrection. You with me? This is foundational. Otherwise, we're sitting ducks, as it were. But the minute something goes wrong in our lives, the minute we do something wrong, here comes the whisperer. See? You couldn't possibly be in Him and do this or think this or fail here. And so there we're separated again, and now we've got to figure out how we get back. Again and again and again we go back. I am in Jesus, in the Father, in the Holy Spirit, and this kudzu thing is being sorted out by the real surgeons. That distinction and that discernment between you and the kudzu is judgment. That is what it means. It means to discern, to divide, to pierce, to go inside the soul, like in Hebrews 4, the Word of God, Jesus, the living Word, is active and sharper than any two-edged sword, and it's able to get inside, and He's the only one that can see the distinctions, and He's unraveling this, and He's asking us to participate. That's part of what I was talking about with my glasses. When He shows us something that we see that doesn't necessarily make sense, He's saying, are you going to take sides with me, or are you going to live in kudzu-dom today? That's where we matter. That's where we, our ongoing decisions count. Now, you see what I'm saying? You with me? Now, my journey, and I've got an essay that, let me read one quote from McDonald too. This is pretty interesting. He says, if you are not willing that God should have His way with you, then in the name of God, be miserable. Till your misery drives you to the arms of the Father. So if you're not willing for God to have His way with you, then go on and eat the kudzu. Just go live in it until it smothers you over to the point to where you're no longer even visible and you're almost disappearing. And finally, you'll run to, in your misery, you'll run to the arms of the Father for salvation, which is the same thing as your discernment, which is the same thing as your deliverance, which is the same thing as His vengeance, because He hates the kudzu and what it's doing to you. All these terms are really looking at the same thing, our deliverance, our liberation. That book, by the way, Christ in Creation, Unspoken Sermons by George MacDonald, it's available on, I know it's available on Amazon. But this edition is done by, it's an edition edited by Roland Hein, H-E-I-N. Top five favorite books of all time for me. These days, probably number one. Goes back and forth between that and T.F. Torrance's book, The Trinitarian Faith. Now, I've just finished an essay that will be published sometime in the new year. And in the journal Participatio, which is the journal of the Theological Society of T.F. Torrance. It will be free, it's online when it comes out. Now, in my in America, the most famous sermon that was ever preached is a sermon by Jonathan Edwards. You may know it. It's called Sinners in the Hands of an Angry God. Now that, I am thrilled to say, is nowhere near the whole of what Edwards was on about. I can quote you Edwards where you would swear he sounded like Paul Young. But I don't know what was going on with him at the time when he preached that sermon. Certainly a bad hair day. It theologically, I mean, it is one of the, where I, the first time I read it was in an American literature class. It was included in the book on literature because it was so beautifully written. And if you just didn't pay attention to what he was saying. But the metaphors and the images, and it was just a beautiful piece of literature in that sense. So we had to read it in our literature, American literature class. And I subsequently found out that it's the most famous sermon in American history. In fact, Jerry Falwell, I don't know if any of you have had the never mind. He wrote a book called The 25 Greatest Sermons Ever Preached. He gathered together these sermons, and it was number one. It was the first one. So it comes right out of this model. God, means sinners in the hands of an angry God. And there's these passages where he says things like, the bow of God's wrath is bent, and the arrow made ready on the bow on the string. And justice strains the bow and aims it at your heart. And it is nothing but the pleasure of God, the mere pleasure of God, and that of an angry God that keeps the arrow one moment from being made drunk with your blood. And people tell me I'm making a straw man over here. Mm-mm. The angry archer is written into the fabric of our Western minds. I suspect it's in the fabric of everybody's mind because it comes from the evil and the whisper. So I think this is what happened. This is why Adam is hiding in the bushes, because God has suddenly ceased to be the Father, Son, and Spirit and become the angry archer. He knows if he comes out from behind that bush, he's going to get an infinite version of who he is, and he's unfaithful and he's fickle. Adam is. So he's projecting his own infidelity. He's tarring the Father's face with the brush of his own anxiety. He's creating a mythological deity that is completely unreal, has no reality in creation at all, but it is very, very real to Adam. And we've been hiding ever since. Now, you remember how I said the other day that that in John 1, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word is turned toward the Father, that word pros, you know, it means to be face to face, it means to be turned toward, it's a word of intimacy. I was looking in John 14:6. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but through me. Guess what word pops up there? I am the way, the truth, and life. No one turns towards the Father but in me. Because we're standing here, we're not coming out from the bushes. We're not going to turn towards that thing. And Jesus is saying, when I am sharing my mind with you, and my heart with you, and my knowledge of the Father, and my communion with the Father, you begin to have courage to turn towards Him. Kudzu and all. No one can do this. This is why no other religion can work. No one can turn towards the Father, because without the consciousness, the conscience of Jesus. I mean, how is it possible that any of us have a clean conscience? I mean, past 13, some of us past 5 or 6, you know. How can we have a clean conscience? It's because we're in Him and He's sharing His clean conscience with us. So, Jonathan Edwards wrote this sermon called Sinners in the Hands of an Angry God, which is the supreme expression of this whole framework that is flowing in our Western conversation. And it goes way, way back, and it comes forward all the way through the thousand years. If you're like me, you grew up with that as normal. I didn't even know that there were many other views of atonement throughout the history of the church. I thought that was the view. That's the only view. God is angry. Somebody's got to come take the arrow. And somehow there's a part of God that loves us enough to send Jesus, and Jesus takes the arrow for us. And then we're supposed to be okay. But then we still stand before this God, and we know He has a quiver full of these things. And He's got two eyes. One of them may be compassion. The other one is just really, really not. It's almost like a glass eye. There's no mercy there. There's this sense of, I'm looking at you. I want to pull the trigger. I want to let the arrow fly. Give me a reason. Now, I don't think that's a straw man at all. I think that's the way we feel. I think that's what that windshield wiper's over here. And we're stuck in that. So, about, I don't know, several years ago, the phrase came to my mind. Here you have sinners in the hands of an angry God, and this phrase comes, God in the hands of angry sinners. And what is happening, and however I got to be in the middle of this conversation, I don't know, but it thrills my soul that what is happening right now at the dawn of the third Christian millennium is we're getting to turn atonement inside out in the light of the Trinity. It's taken us 2,000 years in the West to realize that this discussion of the Father, Son, and Spirit is really, really important. It's not just some doctrine that we all confess in the Nicene Creed or the Apostles' Creed on Sunday and then we go on about our business. In fact, the Roman Catholic theologian Karl Rahner and then several other theologians have come to the same conclusion. Rahner says, David, you'll appreciate this. Where's Dave? Somewhere. Right. Rahner says that if we suddenly had to drop the doctrine of the Trinity as being false, but not true, he says the vast majority of our Christian books would remain the same. You hear what that's saying? He's saying the charge, and he's not just pointing at Protestants. He's talking about the whole Western tradition. He's saying we have this long discussion of the ins and outs of our theology, all the way down to what's going on the cross, all the way down to what is happening in the resurrection and what is happening in the Christian life. All this doesn't even require a Trinity at all. So what is going on right now in history, and this conversation right here is in the middle of it, is that we're recovering this beautiful vision in the New Testament that was developed in the early church of the Father, Son, Spirit relationship, and we are recovering Irenaeus and Athanasius and Hilary and these great theologians who saw this and fought for it. He became what we are. Our Lord Jesus Christ in His transcendent love became what you are, what I am, in the midst of the kudzu, in order to disentangle us so that we could be what He is. That's very different than going to heaven when you die with a robe covering over your kudzu.
Can you use the definition of God in the rest of the catechism as an illustration?
Yes. Although I have tried for 55 years to extricate that definition from my mind. This is the definition of God that I was given as a boy. It's not, I'm not quoting exactly because I have been trying to get this thing. God, no, the question is, what is God? Question number 7 in the Westminster Confession. This is considered the greatest definition of God ever penned in Protestantism. Kid you not. What is God? God is a spirit, infinite in His being, wisdom, and nature, and His holiness, and it goes ripping through holiness, righteousness, justice, mercy, and truth. I left out bits there because I honestly don't remember and I don't want to. Because it's a biblical definition, because I can show you verses that say that about God. But what is so shocking is there is no mention of the Father, Son, and Spirit at all in the definition. And worse, there is no use of the word love in the definition of the nature and character of God. When I first saw that, I was dumbfounded. I thought, how in the world could this be? How can you define God simply as a spirit with all these attributes and leave love and relationship out? And why would you start with what is God? Who reading the New Testament is going to say, what is God? You read the New Testament and say, who is God? And you start with Jesus. And you can't walk 30 seconds into the New Testament without seeing Jesus is the one who has a Father. And somehow in this, and who can understand, the Spirit's right in the middle of it. So if you're going to be even biblical, you're going to start with Jesus, and it's going to be, okay, who is God? God is Father, Son, and Spirit. Now let's talk about all these attributes and names and things. That's fundamental. We're right there. This is what's going on. Somebody asked me the other day, you know, how in the world did you and Paul get where you are? How did that happen? Well, this is part of my discovery when I realized that. I mean, I'm no longer a little 12-year-old boy. I'm somewhere in my early 20s, and I'm thinking, man, this is not good. Because we say the Nicene Creed every Sunday. You know, we believe in God the Father, Almighty, Maker of heaven and earth, in one Lord Jesus Christ, homoousios to patria, and the Holy Spirit. And yet in our definition of God that I was taught, and I think is written into the fabric of our Western modern evangelicalism, and probably Catholicism too, and everything else, is a vision of God that is non-relational, non-Trinitarian, therefore non-Christian, pagan. Now there's a real question for me theologically, is how in the world did that happen? How did we go from Athanasius in the early church to that definition of God? Those of you that are working on doctoral dissertation, that would be a good one to chart that through historically to help us understand. Right now, the Holy Spirit is bringing the entire conversation back around, and this is part of what the shack was about, or is about, back around to the discovery of this relationship. And once you discover this relationship again of the Father, Son, and Spirit, you now have to rethink everything you thought you knew. That does not mean everyone has always been totally, completely wrong. I don't mean that. It's always a mixed bag. As much as I have issues with our brother Augustine, on certain foundational issues, he has a lot of beautiful things to say, including about this relationship. It's not a wholesale dismissal. It is like, to me, it's like when I realized, and I talked to my dad about this one time, I said, "Dad, we went fishing on Father's Day. I took him fishing, and he caught the biggest bass of his entire life on one of my lures." And I was so thrilled. And it was the greatest gift that I could have given him and he could have given me. And we're in this boat together, and I said, "Dad, I need to talk to you about some things." And I said, "I know that you were abandoned by your father when you were 2 years old, and you never knew him." And I said, "I've processed on this." And I said, "I want you to know that that was handed down to me, and that you hurt me. And I'm forgiving you, and I'm giving you a pass. I understand why you are the way that you are, and I bless you for all the good things that you have done, including teaching me how to fish. And I received those blessings. You took care of me. You provided an education for me. I never had a lack of food or clothing, and always had a nice house." And I went down the list of things that I was thankful for. I said, "But you hurt me here. And I don't want to pass that on to the next generation." So that's what we're talking about, is a family conversation where we can stand up and we can say, "That has hurt us. It's not a game. You pass this on to the next generation, they're going to have all kinds of issues that they don't necessarily have to have. We can pass this on. And it's our job to work this out." And at the heart of working this out is, how do we deal with the death of Jesus? John MacLeod Campbell, in the middle of the 1800s in Scotland, was a preacher, and he would pour his heart out on the love of God to his congregation there in Scotland, in Rue. And he could not understand why they could not get it. It was like the love of God was an idea that bounced off the stratosphere of their soul and went back out. They could not receive it. And he worked on this, and it bothered him. And so finally he set about to write a book called The Nature of Atonement. He realized that as long as we have a vision of the death of Jesus as being something aimed at the Father, then that means there's at least two parts of the Father. And therefore, you're never going to be able to receive the love of the Father because you're always afraid of that other side. So there's this division between the holiness, the justice, the mercy, the wrath of God on the one side, and the love and the goodness and the mercy of God on the other. And somehow, in our thinking, the love and the goodness and the mercy sends Jesus to go to the cross so that the justice and the holiness and the righteousness and the wrath of God can be poured out on him, so that the love and the justice and the mercy can then go into action and love us. Somehow something, and that's what people are hearing, not theologically, but they're experiencing this. I'm not going to let go and receive the love of the Father when you got these other things over here on the other side. So part of the beauty of the Trinitarian framework is you take all of those things and you interpret them here. The justice, part of what we were doing last night and this morning, the justice of God is not antithetical to the mercy of God. In fact, they're the same thing. The vengeance of God, the fury, the anger or the wrath of God at our kudzu is in fact his passion for our salvation. It's his love in action. And for me, the wrath of God is perfectly embodied not on the cross, but in Jesus. He is the Father's wrath coming into the far country to find us in our kudzu-infested world and deliver us. And he will accept nothing less than his sons and daughters brought back whole and clean and what, de-kudzu-fied. You see? There's two different notions of satisfaction there. So, I've been working on this for about 55 years. This is one of the burrs under the saddle that I had growing up as a little boy. It took me a long time to even identify as to what I was wrestling with. So what I see happening is that the dream of the Father, Son, and Spirit is that we would be included in this relationship and brought to the place to where there's no longer any sin in us, no longer any darkness in us, no kudzu, that we are completely comfortable and at home in us. in this relationship. There is no darkness in us, no shadows. Not only to be included in this, but for all of that to be removed so that our conscience is clean, we're participating in Jesus fully. And before the foundation of the world, the Father, Son, and Spirit are having this conversation. This is Ephesians chapter 1. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with all the treasures of heaven. I think every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places, which is, I think, is a reference to the Holy Spirit. Just as He chose us in Him to be holy and blameless before Him in love, He predestined us to adoption as sons, which is an inclusive concept, includes daughters. He predestined us to adoption as sons through Jesus Christ to Himself, to the praise of the glory of His grace. Now, when you read the NIV, it says, chosen to be holy and blameless in His sight. Okay? The word, the concept there, guess what it is? It's the image of a bride and a bridegroom. Chose us to be holy and blameless face to face. Now, how different is that than in His sight? You know, there's this distance again. Holy and blameless means we come before God and we're declared legally clean. We're holy and blameless in His sight. That's not what the Apostle Paul is saying in Ephesians 1 at all. He's saying that we were chosen to be before Him, face to face, not only in His heaven, but inside the building. And not just inside the building, but honored guest at His table, and not just honored guest at His table, but seated in Jesus at His right hand, face to face with the Father, in the power and the freedom and the joy of the Holy Spirit. Nothing less than this will satisfy the Father. I want my children with me here in the house. Jesus, You're in charge. Go find them. Do whatever it takes to bring them home. Take the kudzu out. Find a way to get to them inside their darkness. And I've got your back. I will never forsake you. And I'm sending you in with the Holy Spirit. Now you have the Father, Son, and Spirit coming together as a team, as a family, not to be ripped apart, but to find a way to take their communion and find it and a way to establish that communion inside that shack that's covered in the kudzu. This is what you find. When the first time I read the shack, I was dumbfounded. I mean, because you got McKenzie, who goes to the shack the first time, and he's there to have a showdown with G-O-D, the nameless, faceless, omni-being who he's disappointed with, and he has taken his daughter, and he goes to meet God in the shack, and he goes inside, and there's nothing there. There's nothing there. There's no God, there's no words, there's no nothing, because this God only exists in our imaginations. That's the only, it exists by our faith. Athanasius called it mythology. We're projecting it from the way we feel about ourselves, and the evil one is saying, yep, that's right, that's right, that's right, that's right. And we've got all these agreements that we built up, and we've got all this theology that grows. Whew, it's going to be embarrassing. So McKenzie goes to the shack. There's no God. He gets so angry, he slams a chair against the wall and breaks apart, and he takes one of the legs and just beats the floor. You know, where are you? You weren't there for me as a little boy. You were absent. You weren't there for Missy, and you're not here now, and you wrote me a note that told me to be here. Where are you? And he finally just raises his hand and he says, I'm done. I'm out. I'm finished with this. And he walks away. And he's walking back, and you can almost hear the kudzu retreating. Because he walks back and all of a sudden everything changes and he turns around and it's no longer a shack. It's now, did you notice this? It's now a finely built cabin. And there's a white picket fence around it and there's smoke coming from the window, from the chimney. Did you notice that when you read it? See, he turns around and he's no longer in this world of God. He's now in a world he doesn't know about. And you know what? First time we talked on the phone, I asked him this question. I said, you have to tell me. Because the first thing McKenzie hears is what? Laughter. That's right. He hears laughter coming from the cabin. And I said, Paul, did you tell me you did that on purpose, man? Just tell me. He said, oh, yeah, oh, yeah. And you see, he wasn't making a theological statement so much as I was saying. I was looking at this thinking, oh, so you go from G-O-D to Father, Son, and Spirit, and the first hint, everything changes, and now you got laughter. And so he's walking up in there, and he's going to go inside, and he raises his hand again. I don't know if this is exactly accurate, but he raises his hand again, you know, not this time. Where are you? I'm done. I hate you. The only honest answer to G-O-D is I hate you. I hate you. That's it. If you're honest. And McKenzie goes back to knock on the door. Out Papa comes, lifts him up in the greatest hug in the universe, shouting his name like she's known him his whole life. Everybody, even the Pharisees who are reading this crying at this point, even if it's blowing their minds, who doesn't want that? And so what he's done in the shack is he's ripped open the tragedy of Western theology and Western Christianity without a theological word. And every one of us are going, oh man, I can't, what is going on? You know, it's just beautiful. And people, you know, I'm thinking he's got people all over the world talking about the Father, Son, and Spirit. And we got buffoons out there trying to call him a heretic.
Those are my people. Be careful.
I can assure you they are my people too. But they still, it is difficult for me to allow people to write off Paul Young and the shack as heresy, universalism, neo whatever. It is mainline, historic Christianity, which has its origin in this relationship from the foundation of the world. That's what he's talking about. So McKenzie gets lifted off. He doesn't know what's going on. He ends up stepping into the shack, and Sada Yu's coming in like space invading him, and she says she collects tears. And then there's Jesus standing in the corner, and he's got sawdust. You know where the sawdust is from? It's from the kudzu. He's already been preparing the coffin for Mackenzie's great sadness. Mackenzie's inside the shack, which is his own soul, and the Father, Son, and Spirit are already there, already at work redemptively, while he's still angry at G-O-D. He hasn't prayed the prayer. He hasn't jumped through any hoops. His only offering here is anger. This is what I'm bringing into the conversation. I am spitting nails mad at G-O-D. And you can almost hear Papa say, boy, do we have news for you? You know? So, wrestling this through, it's, to me, theologically, it's not going to stick in us. It's not going to be, have the power to begin to affect our, the default settings of our mind until we see what's really going on the cross. As long as we have this idea that somehow Jesus is going to the cross to do something to God, we're in trouble, in my view. And so when you start with the Father, Son, Spirit relationship, you look and you read the shack, here's the issue. Is the Bible, the biblical story about how a righteous God can find a way to declare righteous unclean sinners? Is the issue, how can I declare them righteous who have sinned against me? Or is the issue, how can we get inside their kudzu-infested shacks? Two different questions, isn't it? Father, I desire that the ones that you have given me be with me where I am, that they may behold my glory. See me as your Son and the one anointed and the one who has gathered them together. Father, I have made you. I've made it inside the shack. I have made your name known, and I will make it known, in order that the love with which you love me may be in them and I in them. Now, do you hear that, God saying that? Do you hear that conversation going on inside that solitary individual No, this is the conversation here. And in John's gospel, Jesus says, in order that the love with which you love me, Father, the agape that you have poured forth toward me from all eternity may be in them and I in them. And then it says, when therefore he had finished, he turned. This is the context of the cross. Father, you have sent me to find them in their shacks. I am right here. And this is not going to be pleasant, but I am going to go inside, down into the basement of the shack. I'm going to find a way there. I'm going to get inside of this. And he does this. And you read in John, and it's all through the Gospels. I read through the Gospels one time, all four of them, with one question. What do they tell us is the reason Jesus died? I was expecting to see a bunch of references that fit in with this model. A bunch of references. Well, Jesus went to the cross to suffer the wrath of an angry God, or Jesus went to the cross to satisfy God's justice, or what you find again and again and again. Look at this is just one example. Matthew chapter 20. This is Jesus. Behold, we are going up to Jerusalem, and the Son of Man will be delivered up to the chief priests and scribes, and they will condemn him to death. Thank you, brother.
You're welcome.
You're a kind, gentle man. Behold, we are going up to Jerusalem. You can almost hear him saying this, Father, we're going in. We're going in. And the Son of Man will be delivered up to the angry God. The Son of Man will be delivered up to the chief priests and scribes, and they will condemn him to death. And they will deliver him up to the Gentiles to mock and scourge and crucify him. And on the third day he will be raised up. Again and again you read this. We are going in. We're going in. And we're going into the belly of the beast. And they are going to condemn me. And I'm going to allow them to do that. I am going to allow them to mock me. I'm going to allow them to accuse me unjustly and an illegal trial. And I am going to allow them to beat me with 39 lashes. Now, this is astounding to me. Jesus, I mean, he doesn't even have to say the word and the angels would be there. All he's got to do is think it. You know, and poof, this is all gone. We can start over. But what he is after is not just the Sunday version of us that we present to one another, but he is after the whole us, all of us. And he has to get inside our darkness down to the very bottom in order to do it. And the way that he's going to do that is to allow us to beat him to death. And we are the one that is going to curse him and damn him and beat him and mock him. And we're going to pour our wrath upon him. And he is going to take it. And the Father has got his back. And the Holy Spirit is with him in it, not outside holding tissues. The Holy Spirit is right in the middle of this, suffering with Jesus. It is Jesus in his humanity who's the one who is dying, who's being beaten to death and mocked. And the whole world, and Jesus is saying, the Jews and the Gentiles, the whole world is going to turn against me and pour out their wrath against me, and I am going to take it. I am going to take it. Now, when someone is angry with you, you have several options. One option is to return fire with fire, you know, and escalate the anger. You get angry with me, well, I'll show you, and I get angry right back. That doesn't solve the problem of relationship. It certainly doesn't solve the problem of blindness. Another response is, well, I'm just going, what anger? Who's mad? I didn't hear anything. I'm just fine. And you just deny that there's a problem all the way around. There's no issue. You're not angry. Everything's fine. How's your mama and them? You know, it just gloss it over. Another thing that can be done is that you, and I'm not suggesting this in terms of relationship, I'm using this as an analogy. Another thing you can do is you can submit to the other person, even though you know they're dead wrong. You can submit to them. Jesus can submit to us, even though he knows we're dead wrong and we're blind as bats. That we don't have a clue what is really going on here. And so that's what he does. He submits to us, and as he does, he's stepping inside not only the kudzu and the vines around the shack, he's inside the shack, and now he's inside our blindness. He's behind our glasses. He's inside our hearts. In fact, he's going to say, look, I'm going to take your rejection of me and your murder of me, and I'm going to accept that, and in accepting it, I'm stepping into it, and I'm here now. I'm inside everything that you are. I am accepting you in your as you are in your kudzu. I'm accepting you as you are in your anger. I'm accepting you as you are in your wrath. You're pouring it out. I'm taking it. And I'm accepting it. And in doing that, and not only that, I am going to die. I'm going to let you kill me. And I'm going to let you do it in such a way that, as Paul says so beautifully, this is the most insane torture device in the history of the human race. It's designed to punish and hurt and keep Jesus alive, because when you're on the cross, you start suffocating and your whole body rises and comes back up and starts again in that process. And he's got 39 lashes around his back that come all around to the front. I mean, this is not, and we did this. And he says, okay, this is how this is going to work. I am going to take your rejection of me and your murder and your damnation of me and your curse and your wrath, and I'm going to accept it. And in doing this, I'm going to accept you as you are at your worst. Here's your contribution to the kingdom. I just love this. Here's your contribution. Not only did you not believe, you damned me. And the Father, Son, and Spirit is saying, we will take your damnation of Jesus and we will turn it into our way of including you in our relationship. You see it? Now that's the narrative that begins when you start with Jesus and you come to this conversation, and then you begin to realize that all the way through the entire Old Testament, you have a bunch of people who think God is like this, and all the way through the Lord is saying, nope, not like that, not like that, not like that, not like that. And finally in Jesus, all of this is dumped onto him, and he submits to it, and he allows himself to be damned. And we, and I want you to see, this is so precious to me. This is in the prayer. All of me and mine, every war-torn fragment, every broken, unbelieving, shamed, riddled part is in Jesus, in the Father, in the Holy Spirit, because Jesus was not alone when he went to the cross. Look, listen to this. And wonder, I've just been mystified as to why this verse has been overlooked. It's in the upper room. Jesus says, behold, an hour is coming and has come for you to be scattered, each to his own home, to leave me alone. And yet, I am not alone because the Father is with me. Right there in the upper room. Have you ever heard a sermon preached on that? I mean, that's John chapter 16, verse 32. I'm not alone. I know you're going to run. Peter, I'm counting on you to reject me, and I'll take your rejection and turn that into your adoption. Judas, you're going to betray me. We can use that. Pharisees, do your thing. Pilate, do your waffle. All this lines up. We know that. We got it. And Jesus is stepping into it, giving us a participation in what he's doing. It's just like, are you kidding me? This is so beautiful. The very things that we are the most ashamed of, Jesus has taken up and used as his way inside our darkness. This is where freedom is born, right here. And Jesus says, I know I am not alone. My Father is with me, and the Holy Spirit is with me, and this circle doesn't do abandonment. We don't do rejection. We don't do, sorry, you didn't get it right. This is face-to-face. This is communion. So what you actually have in the biblical story is you have the Father, Son, and Spirit finding a way to take their face-to-face communion, their mutual indwelling, their love, their togetherness, their fellowship, their joy, their burden, their passion, their life, their blessedness, and they found a way to get that inside our shack. And your shack is inside your soul. And they figured out how to do this and use us to help them. And no one knows what's going on. And that's all sort of a parable, made a parable, a living parable for us in the figure of Caiaphas, the high priest. He says, well, it's better for one man to be sacrificed than the Romans to come in and take our place and take away our power structure and our religion. So he says, take Jesus. And so here's the high priest who's doing, the only high priest in the history of Israel who actually did his job, which is offer up the one complete sacrifice, and he never knew it. And he did it for the wrong reason. And Papa says, we can use that. We'll take that. And it all comes together. And the thing that they're counting on from us is that we're going to do the wrong thing. We're going to be faithless. We're going to be treacherous. We're going to betray. We're going to murder. We're going to beat. We're going to mock. And can you imagine the restraint that it took for Jesus? I can't even conceive this. He's holding the entire creation together. Everyone he's looking at is breathing Christological air, and they're mocking him, saying, well, you said you were the Son of God. Come down if you really are who you say you are. I mean, I would have been tempted just to let a little laser go out, you know, just, you know. I mean, really. The humility of Jesus in becoming human is astounding. The humility of Jesus in becoming flesh is astounding. Who can conceive of Jesus becoming sin? He who knew no sin became sin on our behalf in order that we might be the righteousness of God. You know what that means? You know what righteousness means? Flip it over here. Righteousness means you stand right according to the law. Here, righteousness means right relationship. He became sin that we might become right relation, in right relation with His Father and the Holy Spirit and Jesus and with one another and with all creation. So,
Hang on a second.
That was exactly where I was going, actually. There is, just for your information purposes, there is at the back of the book, my book, Jesus and the Undoing of Adam, there's a chapter on this cry. And I want you to see this. And this comes from John McLeod Campbell in his book, The Nature of Atonement. He's the first person that I ever read that saw this. And then I began to realize that this was part of the conversation in the early church, because they didn't see this passage the way we see it. So the point being, and I want to look at three passages. One is just briefly, because we don't have time to go into all of them, but Psalm 22, Isaiah 53, and then Galatians 3. This passage is this quotation, my God, why have you forsaken me? The quotation, the first verse in Psalm 22. And all the Jewish people knew the psalm, like we all know Beatles songs. And, you know, you can hum a line of any of the Beatles songs or any, you know, number one hit, and everybody in the room knows the song, and they'll probably just start humming it, at least maybe even singing it. So Jesus says this, my God, why have you forsaken me? It's the only utterance towards God from Jesus that doesn't start with Father. All of his prayers begin with Father, unlike all of the psalms in all of the history of Israel. So Jesus quotes this. We interpret this here in this model as Jesus, the Father's forsaking the Son. Now, let's just read through this. Psalm 22. So imagine the people. Jesus shouts. This is one of the seven sayings from the cross. He shouts this, my God, why have you forsaken me? The tapes go off. People are singing the psalm. And he says, my God, why have you forsaken me? Far from deliverance are the words of my groaning. Oh, my God. I cry by day, but you do not answer, and by night, and I have no rest. Yet, you can see his emotions, the psalm's emotions. This is what he's feeling. He's feeling like he's rejected. He's feeling like this is the whole world is against him. That's a hard place to stand. It's difficult for us to deal with just one person's disappointment with us. But a whole world disappointed and disgusted? So I'm going to let you deal with the other part. Okay. Yet you are holy, and you are enthroned upon the praises of Israel. In thee our fathers trusted. They trusted, and you delivered them. In thee they cried out, and they were delivered. So he's beginning to get some hope. It feels this way, but I'm beginning to get some hope because I know the history of Israel, and they called out, and you answered them. And then he flips over, and he says, but I am a worm. The proof's everywhere. Everybody's telling me I'm disgusting, I'm a worm and a reproach, and not even a real man. I'm so beaten and broken and a reproach of men and despised by the people. He's dying in the context of being despised by his own people and by the Gentiles, the whole world's talking about despicable me. And all who sneer me, who see me sneer at me, and they separate the lip and they wag the head. Commit yourself to the Lord. Let him deliver him. Let him rescue him because he delights in him. This is what Jesus is experiencing. He says, yet thou, you, are the one who brought me from my mother's womb, and you made me trust upon my mother's breast. Upon you I was cast from birth, and you have been my God from my mother's womb. Do not be far from me, for trouble is all around, and there is no one to help me. Not one. Many bulls have surrounded me. Bulls of Bashan have encircled me. They open wide their mouth, a ravening and roaring lion, and I'm poured out like water, and all my bones are out of joint. That's that thing about the suffocation. Your shoulders are coming undone, and it's just you're held together, and it's horrible. All my bones are out of joint, and my heart is like wax. It is melted within me. My strength is dried up like a potsherd, and my tongue is so dry, I'm so dehydrated, my tongue cleaves to my joints. And you lay me down in the dust of death. For the dogs have surrounded me, and a band of evildoers have encompassed me, and they have pierced my hands and feet. I can count all my bones. They look and they stare at me. They divide my garments, and from my clothing they cast lots. But you, O Lord, don't be far off. You, my help, hasten to my assistance. Deliver my soul from the sword and my life from the power of the dog. Save me from the lion's mouth and from the horns of the wild oxen. Answer me. And then I will tell of your name to the brethren. And in the midst of the assembly, I will praise you. You who fear the Lord, praise him, descendants of Jacob, glorify him and stand in awe of him, you descendants of Israel. For he has not despised nor abhorred the affliction of the afflicted, neither has he hidden his face from him. But when he cried to him for help, he heard, he answered. And see, Jesus has got the whole bunch that has rejected him singing a psalm that's going to land them right here in a completely different interpretation from what they think is going on. It's astounding. And then this goes, wow, this scene of Psalm 22 goes right into Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. And then that goes right into Psalm 24. When it says, lift up your gates and be lifted up, O ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in. You have in these Psalms, and the way that they're structured and handed on to us, you have the death of Jesus. You have the Father's rescue of Jesus. You got the Holy Spirit's quickening of Jesus, and you have the ascension of Jesus going home right here. We cannot see this because that's where we were, and McLeod Campbell saw it. And to this day, he catches flack for that interpretation. And I'm like, dude, you got some work to do in terms of the exegesis if that is not the central point there. He did not hide his face. No way in the world is this father going to reject this son. That's the one relationship in all of creation that you can count on. And George MacDonald says so beautifully, as long as the Father loves the Son and the Son loves the Father, all is well with the little ones. You see, back to in that day you will know that I am in my Father. Our comfort, our hope is really in the fact that Jesus and the Father are one. Homoousios to patri. Now, there's a lot more to be talked about in that psalm, and Paul can speak to this in very profound and personal ways, because Jesus is identifying with us. What is it like for the Father, Son to get inside our shack where it's dark and all we know is G-O-D? He's identifying with us. He's saying, I'm here, Adam. I'm standing on your side with you in the bushes. I see the God that you see. I know what you feel. I'm not going there, but I'm identifying. I'm finding you at the root of your sin and your darkness. And I'll leave the rest for Paul to speak to. And then quickly, Isaiah 53. These two passages were the ones that I was taught, or at least always, you read all the books, these are the two that they build the entire superstructure of penal substitution on, these two passages. And I just find it amazing. And We don't have time to read the whole Psalm, but I just want to read one part. 53. Let's start at verse 1. Who has believed our message, and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For he grew up before him like a tender shoot and like a root out of parched ground. He has no stately form or majesty that we should look upon him with any honor. He no appearance that we should be attracted to him. And you're seeing Jesus that is absolutely beaten to a pulp, to the point to where Pontius Pilate says, you know, behold the man. You know, the man, he's not, he looks like a beaten down pulp. So, verse 3, he was despised and forsaken. What's it say next? He was despised and forsaken of men. And like one from whom men hide their face, he was despised, and we did not esteem him. So what is Isaiah seeing? Who's doing the despising? Who's doing the hiding? Surely our griefs he himself bore, and our sorrows he carried. Yet we ourselves esteemed him stricken, smitten of God. We interpreted it this way. We despised him. We thought God was despising him and afflicting him too. But he, and this is where there's a fascinating discussion of translations, he was wounded, or and it's either pierced or wounded by our transgressions or for our transgressions. And the word there, and then the next verse it says, and he was crushed for or by our iniquities, and the chastening of our well-being fell upon him. All of us like sheep have gone astray. And by his scourging we are healed. All of us like sheep have gone astray. Each has turned to his own way, but the Lord has caused the iniquity of us all to fall on him. Now that's the passage that's really important. We think he's being afflicted by God. We think he's being despised by God. Isaiah sees what's happening. He's in the arena of our rejection of him, and we're despising him. We're trying to interpret this as being smitten. And so the end of verse 6, but the Lord has caused the iniquity of us all to fall on him. The Hebrew word is there is paga. It means to cause, to encounter, or meet. Now think about this. Iniquity, remember, is not transgression. Transgression is to transgress the law. Iniquity is when you raise your fist at God and you banish him. I don't want anything to do. It's McKenzie. I hate you. I hate you. I hate you. And the Lord is causing our hatred of him to fall upon, to meet, to encounter Jesus. And to me, when I read that, I'm thinking, I now see what's happening. Jesus is going to enter into, he's not only going to die, he's going to die at the hands of our iniquity, at our hatred. And he is going to suffer from us our despising, our brutality. And he's going to accept that. And the Lord is saying, this is how this is going to work, Jesus. You're going to go in and you're going to go all the way to the bottom and you're going to take all of that. And it's all going to be funneled down on you, and you're going to go right there, and you're going to submit to it. And I've got your back, and the Holy Spirit's in this with you, and we're going to come out the other side. We are coming out the other side. You are going to be scattered. You're going to pour out your wrath. I'm going to take it. But listen, I am not alone. The Father is with me, and we're stepping into this together. So what you have in the whole movement of Jesus' life to the cross is you have the communion of the Father, Son, and Spirit, the blessed communion, the face-to-face relationship, this other-centered love. You have this communion descending, not only into our humanity in humility, but into our flesh. And not only into our flesh, but on the cross, it's descending into our iniquity. And it's pitching its tent right there in the context of our hatred of God, right there in the context of all the kudzu. And what is being pitched there is not simply Jesus, but Jesus in his union and communion with his Father, and Jesus in his anointing in the Holy Spirit. Now, what's going to happen when the life of the Father, Son, and Spirit descends down into that death as it's crushed by our iniquity? It's not going to stay there long. there is going to be resurrection. Our iniquity cannot kill the life of the Father, Son, and Spirit. So the crucifixion and death of Jesus underneath our curse and damnation and our iniquity, and Jesus takes, he meets us there at the rock bottom of the abyss, and there the life of the Father, Son, and Spirit comes to life again in his person, and he comes forth out of the grave in resurrection. And of course, as we were saying yesterday, he was not alone. He had us and the whole world with him. I love this. Jesus, the Father said, okay, you will murder my son. I will use your murder of my son to resurrect you. I will put you to death as you murder my son, and I will bring you out the other side. Because this is not simply a single solitary Lone Ranger Marlboro man. This is the one in whom all things are created and are held together. When he dies, we die. When he rises, we rise. So it is a beautiful, creative, redemptive act of genius. I'll take your crucifixion of my son and use it to crucify you, deliver you from the kudzu, and bring you out the other side with him, in union with me and in union with the Holy Spirit. You see that? We're going to be marveling at that for generations, for all eternity. One last passage, and these are just hitting the tips. We can have these conversations around lunch and things. Verse in Galatians chapter 3, verse 13, Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law, having become a curse for us. For it is written, cursed is everyone who hangs on the tree. Now that is a quotation from Deuteronomy, I believe, 21. Now, I want you to see this. That passage used to bother me a lot. I didn't understand what in the world Paul was doing. But I want you to listen to Deuteronomy 21, 23. It says, his corpse shall not hang all night on the tree, but you shall surely bury him on the same day. For he who is hanged on the tree is cursed by God. So the Apostle Paul quotes that passage and he says, cursed is everyone who hangs on the tree. Do you notice anything different? The Apostle Paul misquoted Deuteronomy. He did. Now, he wasn't being in error there. It's part of the tradition. And John McMurray talks about this. When you have a quotation of Moses or a quotation of one of the other writers in the Scriptures and it's not quoted exactly the same way, then that's your commentary on what you think the man was saying. And so that's when I looked at this and I thought, the Apostle Paul deliberately leaves cursed by God out and leaves it with cursed is everyone who hangs on the tree. And I think that's because he does not see Jesus as suffering a curse from his Father at all. He sees Jesus as bearing our curse that we poured on him. And in taking that, Jesus Christ, our blessed Lord Jesus, our brother, who in his transcendent love became what we are, met us in our darkness and in our sin and in our iniquity, and allowed himself to be crushed by it in order to identify with us and meet us there, lay hold of us. And then he took us right on down in death, lifted us up in his resurrection, in his Father, in the Holy Spirit, above all rule and authority and name that is named both in this age and the age to come. Hallelujah. Now we're going to see this. We are going to see this because the Holy Spirit is not about to allow us to sit in Jesus, in the Father, in the Holy Spirit with all this kudzu and all this blindness and all this darkness. Nope. And so the Holy Spirit is saying, take sides with me today. Take sides with me right now against the way you see things. That's how you get there. That's how you move from that model or what that world of darkness into a fuller experience of the Trinitarian life. Now, I think that's enough. What time is it? 12:05. Is that right? Let's close together with a prayer. Lord Jesus, this is breathtaking. This is beyond our imaginations that you are this good. and that you have had this plan in your heart with your Father in the Holy Spirit before the time of the ages, and that you knew and that you ran to become what we are and even to enter into our flesh, and you went to the cross to bear it all so that you could lay hold of us at our worst. We worship you. We kneel down our whole lives for you. We give you our hearts, our souls, our minds, our bodies, all of me, all of us. Everything that we are, we bring to you, Jesus, and we ask you, please, Jesus, give us your eyes right here. We don't want to see things the way we see them anymore. And we don't want to be led by some harebrained theologian from across the pond. We want to you to lead us, Jesus. You give us these eyes. You seal this upon our hearts. You affirm this, this truth, this light, and you use this to liberate us. And thank you for finding us down in the very depths of our own shacks where we are almost choked to death by the kudzu. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. You are our high priest. You are our savior and our saving act and our king and our liberator and the healer of our broken souls. To you be glory and honor and adoration and worship now in this age and in all the ages to come. Amen. Thank you.